It's snowing! And if you would like it to be snowing, even if it's not snowing where you are, follow the steps in this tutorial to get some Trapcode Particular snow!
Hello, I'm Michael Zlapsky, and in this tutorial, I'm going to show you kind of a hidden feature in Trapcode Particular that helps you make the particles really feel like they're in your scene a little more than just slapping them on top of everything. It's not something that a lot of folks know about, and I'm going to show you a couple of tricks to make it work really well for you. Now, you notice in this scene that I made here, I've got snow that goes in front of me and behind me, but then it's clear that I'm in front of a lot more of the snow than the trees are. And you might think, well, hey, you could just have snow on a layer, and then you on a layer, and then a different layer of snow, and then a different layer of trees, and then a different layer of snow, and a different layer of trees. And then, you know, a final fourth layer of snow for the different backgrounds. And yes, you know, you could do that. But then what if you say, if you or your client go like, hey, we need that snow to blow more, or to have, you know, more snowflakes or fewer snowflakes, and you're like, ah, crap. And you have to adjust the physics on, you know, settings and, you know, the wind on every single one of those Trapcode layers, it would just get annoying. No, I'm going to show you how to do it all on one layer with a special technique called depth maps, or as Trapcode Particular calls it, the Z buffer. And the basic principle is this: the more something is white, the closer to the camera it is, and the more something is dark, the further from camera it is. Now, how do you make this in a video shot? And how do you control it great for your working with Trapcode Particular? Well, I'm gonna show you a couple little techniques. So let's hop into After Effects here. And I'll kind of walk you through how I made this shot. Now, you'll see if I solo these particles here, you'll see that you can clearly see the outline of my body here. Just a few snowflakes passing across in front. You'll see this tree here is definitely got more snow passing in front of it. And then this tree back here, you can kind of vaguely see its area there because it's further back. And that's all happening because of this depth mat here. And you can see we've got, oh yeah, and the birds. So you got the birds, this tree and me, and you see the different shades of gray. And they're all being controlled very handily with essential graphics. These essential properties here are letting me determine in this comp how bright each one is. So if the person needed to be a little further back, you know, so I can make it look like I'm behind the tree snow-wise, but you know, you wouldn't want to do that. But yeah, you got the control here, and that's driving properties inside of this depth mat comp. Let me show you what I'm talking about here. Actually, no, Timmy, let me take you to the beginning. The very first thing is just I shot this on an iPhone, parametric curve, and colorista, kind of give this weird kind of twilight hazy look. I was kind of going for something a little more whimsical. Then I used a Primatte Keyer to pull the trees out. And then for me, let me hop in the depth map here. On me, I used the rota brush and After Effects just to pull me out. Oh, and the birds are an asset from Action VFX. So it's just these fake birds flying. And I just wanted to add a little bit of something else moving in the background there, so it wasn't just this kind of blank sky. So I got a few fake birds flying by. And for each one of these layers, I got tree mid here is the keyed shot of the tree, which also happens to have me in it, but that's fine because I've got the rota brush of me laying over top of it. And then this tree background over here, same shot, just masked off. And on each one of these, if I go to my effect panel, you'll see I've got it filled to be black. My solo layer there, show transparency. I've got it filled black, and then I'm adding the tint effect over top with pure white. And then the amount of tint is how I control how bright or dark a layer is. Make a little square layer here just to show things off. It's pure black. And I add the tint effect to it. Make everything pure white. See how I'm able to control that there. We are, I should point out, in aces, so it's not going to look pure white. But it's pure white. And amount of tint. So if I want to be able to control this in the other comp, I just have to go to my essential graphics panel and say, hey, what property do I want to control up there? Well, it's the amount of tint. And I'll say square depth. Right now it's at 100%, so it's fully white as far as the depth map is concerned. Unsolo those things. Then back here in the main comp, I've got control in my essential properties for the square depth. So I can say, hey, how bright or how dark do I want this to be? And this lets me control, me get rid of that square there. Don't need it anymore. Yes, delete. So that gives me the ability in my composition here, like in context of the particles, to decide how deep I want things to be. Let me talk you through how I made kind of this snow itself. There are presets here in the designer that can get you started with making the snow, but the important thing is that I've got this very large emitter that is, you know, filling the whole scene for as close as I want the snowflakes to be to as far back as I want them to be. So it's a very large emitter, and up high enough and wide enough that all the falling snow, if I solo this layer again, all the falling snow just kind of fills the area. It doesn't kind of tail off of the edges there. It's nice and wide. So everything is just fills the whole screen. And the important thing is right down here in the visibility section for the Z buffer. It's where I put my depth map. And you could say the depth at black is, you know, a certain number, and the depth at white is a certain number. So that's how many of After Effects units back it is. So we're saying from 0 to 20,000 in that space, going from white to black. So the brighter something is, the closer it's going to feel as the particles get cut off more and more. If I move this person to be, you know, darker, you'll see more snow start showing up in this area. Versus if I make it all the way bright, you'll see no snowflakes show up. So I was looking at this and I thought, you know, for the scale of scene, that felt like, you know, a good number to go at. And if you're interested in the actual snow itself, I really didn't change all that much. One of the handy things about Trapcode Particular's designer is that you can see when it's bright white what something is changed. I mean, double-clicking on it will return to the default. So I've got, you know, since it's a lot of snow, I've got quite a lot of particles per second. And like I said, I moved the emitter kind of up and over so that it fills the whole screen. Just set the velocity to 0 on this tab, not much change there. Size affects air resistance on the particles is up a little bit because I want them to feel a little more realistic. So the larger particles will be blown more by the wind. I feathered it a bit, made it a cloudlet, and made them last a lot longer in their life. Just in case a particle happens to die as the wind blows it around in here before it's supposed to, before it gets off the screen, I don't want it to pop out. So I've got my opacity, which I've set at 50% for all of them to make them feel a little more integrated in the scene. I've just kind of sloped that down. Didn't change anything in color. And then, or any of the other chips in here, all it changed is the environment. I got some gravity to make the snow come down, got some wind blowing it to the left and back a little bit to match the wind that was in the actual footage that was shot of me in the palm tree. I got air turbulence that affects the position somewhat, moving it with the wind, so it kind of feels like it's gusting around, and then just fussed with how the turbulence looks just a little bit to get the kind of snow moving that I thought fit the wind in our scene. Now, this was a handheld shot originally, so if I unhide all this stuff, you can see I've got some spot clone tracker that I used on this shot to track it, and then applied that same tracking information back, but in reverse, so I stabilized the shot so everything was sitting perfectly still. Did the same thing in the depth mat and this one, so that the particles, I wouldn't have to mess with trying to camera track the particles into the scene. So everything was perfectly still, made the particles happen. Then I used Supercomp. I should point that out as well. I turn it back on. Supercomp just, open the Supercomp panel up here real quick. So I turn it off and on. You see how much more integrated that snow feels into the shot. It's just kind of picking up all the colors from outside. Also the birds fit into the shot better as well. Right now they're a little too dark. All I did in Supercomp is I applied some light wrap to the birds and some haze to the birds at the kind of default settings for the haze, and just lightened the light wrap somewhat. And then put some blur behind on the snowflakes. So where it's a little bit transparent here with the motion blur, it kind of blurring what's kind of behind it just helps it sit and feel set in the scene more. Plus they're all 50% opacity anyway. And then a bit of haze to help them really sit in with the color scene. So we're here, Supercomp off. Looks like that, which is, you know, it's not bad, but Supercomp really just helps everything sit into the scene and feel like it belongs. But then again, like I said, this is a completely still scene. The camera's not moving around. It's just the snow's falling and I'm talking. So in my actual main comp here, I brought back the original camera motion and added a bit of extra movement with some universe camera shake. Just using the handheld preset. And then some Magical Looks. Now, in Magical Looks, I do have, if you notice here, in Magical Looks, I got some diffusion to help, you know, against just so that everything was shot together, but, and some, you know, some vignette and other stuff to make it look nice. But the important thing is I have lens distortion on here. And the important thing is that I have to put the lens distortion on after the camera shake, because otherwise your camera distortion will be moving around with the camera, the fake camera movement, and that just cannot stand. So there you go. A nice way to get Trapcode Particular to sit nicely in your scene. You just got to cut out each element with masking or rotoscoping or keying that you want to have each different layer, and then set it up like I showed you with the tint effect to easily control it inside your main comp. And of course, if you're using a 3D renderer like Redshift, you can just tick on to have a depth pass put out for you that automatically has everything at its correct depth, and you can easily integrate your Trapcode Particular particles in any scene.